right, so everyone, welcome to the New Jersey NATS second Sunday series. And this is our third in our inaugural series this fall. And today we welcome Dr. Lourin Plant. And I want to tell you just very briefly about him, because then he's going to take the rest of the hour to talk to us about singing African American spirituals, which is something that I know is near and dear to his heart, but it's actually quite near and dear to my heart too, Dr. Plant. We'll have to have that conversation sometime. And he is also generously sharing his file with us, and that will be on the website at some point in the near future, along with this recording. So Dr. Plant is music professor at Rowan University, where he leads a diverse schedule of teaching studio voice, directs the Collegium Musicum, and teaches as part of the Bantivoglio Honors Concentration and Africana Studies programs. He has done a lot of these presentations on African-American spirituals, featured in state, national, international forums. His articles have appeared in the Classical Singer magazine and the Journal of Singing. And I want to read you this sentence because I think it's a beautiful sentence, and it'll lead us right into his presentation. In his presentations on spirituals and narratives, Dr. Plant has traced the central history of the spiritual and its repertoire, their role in the witness and transcendence of African American slaves, their continuing presence in advancing the civil rights movement, as well as how spirituals have greatly shaped American musical traditions. So we welcome Dr. Plant.
Well, I'm very happy to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me. And I'm so happy about NATS offering this second Sunday series, because there are so many interesting topics to connect with. The last topic with Florence Price's music was just really excellent. And so I want to offer a few ideas like that, and hopefully people can take them and run with them if they find them useful in their educational setting. So I guess I would like to share my screen, and I'm going to share with you this PowerPoint, which will be available in the chat, and will also, you'll be able to have it afterwards as well. So let's see. Okay, I got to move a few things to make this work, but here.
There
we go. So, and I'm going to close this just a little bit so I can see my full screen. So this is a talk about spirituals, and actually it's too much for one. I'm planning 55 minutes, but it's too much for that. And so I'm going to jump through as much as I can to help keep you on track. And then some of it, I think you will be able to navigate yourselves. But I want to encourage you to think about this subject, because spirituals are so central to American music, and it tells so much about America to the world. So yes, so this next screen is one of the friezes from Portia Maltzby's book on African-American music. And here she has like a diagram that focuses on how African-American contributions to music have really spread out across the culture. And so on the left-hand side, we can see that folk spirituals are here and principally have gone all the way down that sacred line through gospel, through gospel hymns, all the way to the modern era through gospel hip hop, if you will. So African-American spirituals are connected to a lot, but also you can see that it also connects with arranged spirituals, and African-American music generally spreads out all over these areas. So not only blues and ragtime and vaudeville and quartets and early jazz and and then eventually rock and roll and soul into more popular forms. So all of this music, these contributions by African Americans really spread out across our culture, and the so-called folk spiritual is really an important aspect of it. I wanted to at least get into our ears a tiny bit of music today at the very beginning, and we want to hear a tiny bit of Marian Anderson's her performance of Deep River, arranged by H.T. Burley. And she sounds so beautiful. Marian is one of the early pioneers of performing African-American spirituals on the concert stage, which is different from where they came from. They actually came from congregational or group meetings, and these were like group singings. With those wonderful settings by Burley and by others at the turn of the century, this music transcended that setting and was offered to the world. And so here is a tiny bit of Marianne singing. Let's just give her a half of a verse if we would, but the entire thing is there, Deep River. And then she goes on and reaches that very climactic high E, and her voice is so fresh and so beautiful in this setting. We want to go on to the next slide. And this one kind of introduces the idea that the African-American spiritual is unique among all of the African diaspora, that it is, even though Africans went in slavery to South America and to the Caribbean islands, a great number of them, as a matter of fact, they estimate from 10 to 100 million people, they found that only in America did they create this kind of music. And so it's significant to us. And that there's a very large collection that remains. It's one of the largest folk collections to reach the 21st century. And they open to us, I think, a witness to American slavery and an important aspect of our history. So they illuminate, I think, in many ways, the singing soul of the Africans that were brought here, and they reveal in many ways the optimism that transcended the American slave experience. And that is that's a light actually to us in this century. About background, and I guess background was the first topic that I put in the outline, but I think it actually is foreground. I think in order to really understand how spirituals have their power and where they get their power, we do need to know the ground that lies before us. It is, of course, African-American spirituals are a remnant of the encounter between African and European culture in the American South under slavery. And Africans brought to America were largely transported here under the transatlantic slave trade. And I think that's where we have to kind of look at before we get into spirituals, and I'll try to go through this quickly. Of course, it's the largest forced transatlantic migration in world history. And W.E.B. Du Bois said that 100 million Africans came across in this way. But it's actually, they're finding that maybe he used that number to really kind of shock the American consciousness into the responsibility about this event. But they are finding that between about 12 million people they can account for, although there are quite a few that they cannot account for. These were transported in at least 36,000 documented voyages. I think that that number may be up to 64,000 transported voyages as the scholarship continues to roll forward. I list the average slave ship took about 30 to 90 days. That's 3 months. And by the 19th century, as technology improved, particularly the shape of the sail and navigation across the Atlantic, they could make that journey even faster, between 16 and 20 days. And so there was a real expansion of American slavery during the 19th century. Slave ships could carry quite a large number of them, many of them as small as 450, and the largest vessels were 800 slaves packed in, and the mortality rate was enormous. They suggest from 30% to 50%. And we can take a look at how this took place. We can see that they came from all over Western Europe in order to participate in this this venture. Brazil, of course, had its own direct link between Africa, so it went back and forth across the Atlantic in order to do their trade. But the others from Europe had a triangular shape, and that's how the slaves ended up in the Caribbean islands, and a very small portion of them directly here in the United States. They came from Western Africa largely, and from the central part of Western Africa, and making those treks across the land to get to the shores, to get to the coastline, and those barracoons, and then from there across the Atlantic. I guess the trade was to send manufactured goods from Europe and for people along the African coast, and those people taken across the ocean for all kinds of goods that they could trade for. So sugar, cotton, tobacco, these are the raw materials that eventually went to America and also to other places back to Europe. So the triangular slave trade was complete. As I said before, about 500,000 of the slaves actually made it to the United States, even though we see a huge number that came from Africa, that and even more were lost in transit. People from all kinds of tribes from Western Africa, the Ashanti, the Bantu, the Fanti, the Hausa, Igbo crew, the Mandinko, yes. And so the rate of trade, I guess we can see that from the diagram that I made there, it is the 50 percentile. I guess most of the enslaved Africans came during the 18th century. And so it started early, and then as it became more and more popular, it, of course, became a world phenomenon. There are many elements that the spirituals that we are looking at deal with that transcend from American slavery. That is the middle passage, the transportation from Africa to Americas, the auction block, the coffles, those are the chained people that were led together from the auction block to wherever they were sold to go. Life on the plantation, religious conversion, the resistance by running away or singing songs of resistance, songs about freedmen and women, eventually emancipation, lots of songs about that, and then survival and transcendence. So these spirituals and narratives actually talk about all of these things. And those elements actually go together, spirituals and narratives. We'll talk a little bit about the narratives later. But for now, the last facts about the slavery, American slavery, there was a minority of owners that actually held slaves. To hold a slave, to hold an enslaved person was actually a sign of status. And by the last part of the antebellum period, we see that there were almost a little more than a half a million slave owners in the American South. And most of these slave owners held less than 20 slaves, but of course, we know that there were some that were enormous plantations with thousands of slaves. The slave owners themselves were a concentrated minority. They say about 1% of the owners in the South actually controlled the politics and the economy of the entire region, and indeed of the entire nation, the economy was built upon American slavery, both North and South. And in 1865, when emancipation finally took place as a result of the Civil War, then there were 4 million Americans, African Americans, that were set free into the country. I have a tiny video, I hope it will work. I wanted to talk about slave melodies. And of course, slave melodies have this largely pentatonic tune. Although later, as the intersection between African tunes, African singing, and American singing in the South, they start to expand that scale. So the pentatonic scale, da 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 da, becomes da 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 eventually. And that leading tone becomes one that we recognize almost immediately as it makes an impact in the music. Here's a tiny, this is me playing the piano and trying to video myself at the same time. So caution on this. I don't recommend this for others.
The pentatonic scale is easily shown here on the piano as the black notes on the keyboard. Actually,
that's it.
That's the scale right there. And so many of the early spirituals fall into that category. For example, etc. Another one that's like that is sometimes I feel like a motherless child,
which is kind of minor pentatonic, so to speak.
Scale with a leading tone at the end. That happens also in another African American spiritual, for example, Wade in the Water. also shows that influence of the Western European scale. With a leading tone at the end, Wade in the Water.
So, well, so these pentatonic song forms grew and actually were very popular in their original settings. That would be devotional settings where Africans, these enslaved Africans, were singing and trying to find their way through American slavery. Once slavery was ended, many of the historically Black universities, like Fisk University, in this case, the Fisk Jubilee Singers, and other African-American composers developed these forms in a way that we can explain them to the world. And so we find that these spirituals come in several different kinds of forms. Traditionally, of course, the call and response form seems to be traditionally African. We also find that many of the slow songs or the so-called sorrow songs have that structure, 3+1 in their refrains, where the text is repeated three times. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. And then it's completed a long ways from home. There are many jubilees that are very, very upbeat and very, scintillating and spine tingling with their energy. There are many spirituals that are the longer, complex narrative structures built on biblical verses. And then there is a group that we consider to be complex and hidden meaning songs that are code songs about resistance and escape. Here, this is a call and response version of so many of the spirituals in this form, I guess. This is one by H.T. Burley, and this one is Deep River. I beg your pardon, that's not Deep River. This is actually, it's supposed to be Swing Low Sweet Chariot. Let's see if we can change. No, that is, there it is. Yes, that's it. Here's a very good example of the call and response. So the verse, I looked over Jordan, and the response is, and the call is, and the response would be, and then the refrain would go again. So yes, so this is from Robert McFerrin's Deep River album. It's all online. It's recorded in 1957, and it's beautifully digitalized online, and the entire album is there, and I would definitely recommend it. It's one of my favorites. His voice is just absolutely perfect in that setting. The second grouping was sorrow songs, and of course, the sorrow songs are intensely melancholic, describing many aspects of slave earthly troubles, and really calling out on the name of Jesus for salvation. And these songs many times had a rhythm to them that would also help people move their bodies and ease the burden of labor. They also have a sense of change, a sense of hope, and a sense of ultimate justice and personal worth. And there are many songs in that category, like Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child, and Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen, I've Been in the Storm So Long, Fix Me Jesus, Round About the Mountain. This one is a tiny bit of Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child, arranged by Moses Hogan with Alfred Walker as the bass. Just a fragment of it. This is the middle of the second verse. Beautiful recording of the transcendence of that piece, A Long Ways From Home. I do love that recording, and Moses Hogan's works are really wonderful. There's a wonderful anthology of his music that remains. This next one is one of my favorites. I usually would just choose one sorrow song, but how can you not have Florence Quivar singing Round About the Mountain? This one is a spiritual arranged by Roland Hayes, and she sings so beautifully. I think I can give you just a pinch of this. This is from the beginning, but I think I should jump just a bit if I can. That idea of rising and transcending is so amazing. The color of her voice, the way she moves between the notes, the way she that minor third, the way she kind of bends on that minor third, the way she bends their notes, she's terrific. Who can sing like Florence? She's amazing. Here is an example of a Jubilee song, and maybe I can take a tiny bit of this one as well. This is the so-called camp meeting songs, really upbeat, really fast, syncopated. These are among the ones that really win a lot of young people to these songs because of the energy that's in them. This one is an arrangement by Moses Hogan as well, with Angela Brown singing Walk Together Children. I'm going to jump to the second half of this, okay?
Thank you.
for all you sopranos that want to sing a high C, Mr. Hogan makes that available to you. You don't have to interpolate that note. It's written out there for you. So such a great and wonderfully driven piece. Another category of spirituals would be the so-called complex narrative structures on biblical texts. Sometimes they tell entire stories like Witness or Take My Mother Home or Balming Gilead or Go Down Moses. This one, I think, is Kevin Maynor and Kevin singing an arrangement by Lawrence Brown, Joshua Fit the Battle. And I think this piece lasts 50 seconds or 58 seconds, so we'll hear the whole thing. Wow. So it tells the entire story of Joshua fighting the battle. And many of these spirituals have taken these biblical texts and expanded upon them in a way that makes them accessible to the stage. I'm going to go a little further. This one is a hidden meaning song or a coded song. And it has to deal with the idea of the Underground Railroad, as so many of these songs about running away may actually have connection. Many are associated with the Underground Railroad, and they use terminology about railroads or traveling and tickets. These are all ideas about the so-called Underground Railroad, like in the spiritual, if I got my ticket, can I ride? Or the gospel train. And that's the one I think we'd like to hear. Although there are many others, like the famous one, Steal Away to Jesus, or Follow the Drinking Gourd, or Swing Low Sweet Chariot is one of those, or Wade in the Water, Go Down Moses. There are so many terrific ones. This is William Warfield singing just a pinch of the gospel train. I'm going to jump to the middle. Oh, I beg your pardon. I better start again. And then the train idiom. Bravo. So we get a sense of the idiom being played out in the music and in the text together. I'm going to go on to one of the important aspects, particularly for people who want to add their own quality or their own style of singing in these spirituals, by improvising and interpolating all kinds of notes into them. Of course, that was a tradition that comes from slave group singing, where people would stand or sit and sing and interpret the song in their own way. And many believe that this kind of a cappella style of singing is the most expressive type of spiritual performance. We have great accompaniment to many of the spirituals, but they can be reduced to just singing the voice and the text and the expression that the singer brings to it. I have several of these. I don't know if we can get through all of them. I think I'm just going to give you a little bit of each one, maybe a half a minute if I could. Scandalize my name.
Just as soon as ever my back was turned, he went and scandalized my name.
Real, it's a wonderful, wonderful piece. And as you go on, you can add more individuality. And I think that's what a lot of singers want to do to standard arrangements, but we have to kind of caution them in that way. If you really feel like you want to improvise a great deal, then maybe the best thing to do would be to take the melody and words and then interpret it yourself in that way. Here's Florence Quivar. Right, you can bend the notes, you can sing them, you can add small melismatic passages the way in the tradition that many singers have done over the years. Here is Jesse Norman in that same kind of a cappella style. Yeah, she does it so beautifully, the way she bends a note and how she presents the strength of the melody initially, and then she adds more of her individual quality as she goes forward in this format. I really feel like a cappella singing, the a cappella style or spirituals, the unaccompanied style it could be the most expressive and individually expressive. Let me see if I can get off this page. There we go. Okay, so now we have to kind of deal with dialect. Now I'm keeping on. Okay, well, go faster, Plant. Okay, the idea, if you're uncomfortable with dialect, the idea that less is more. I try to get some of my students to think about the idea that dialect, particularly American slang, is very close. It has tentacles connecting to slave speech patterns of the last two centuries. And we find that if you're uncomfortable doing dialect, there are many spirituals that are not dialect spirituals. I think of Deep River, for example. There's very little dialect in that. And there are many spirituals that are available to that, but there are quite a few that are in dialects. So sometimes you have to kind of make a decision how you're going to go forward. Remembering that it's an approximation of speech patterns. And we try to get you to encourage you to avoid exaggerations in your pronunciations. I guess as a background or a foreground note, 70% of the enslaved African ancestors came from the Mende tribes or the West African and Bantu ethnic groups. And for over 300 years, as they lived in the American South, 90% of these African Americans in the American South, that actually accounts for the southernness, what we now know of as the American Southern accent, that there is a great deal of African American English style in that accent and in that sense of expression. And so most of the Africans that came to the United States, they did not have that TH sound in their languages. And so that TH sound being alien became difficult for them to pronounce. And so rather than that sound, they came up with Dan. They tried to make that sound. And so they became day, and the or the became the or D, and that became that, etc., and this and wid, and in the middle of a word like father became fader. And they also, there are some Scottish dialect connections with this. There is also that th sound that's final at the end of the word. I even hear this as a vestige of American slave speech patterns in my own family from Georgia. For example, the word mouth, they try to make that sound at the end of the word, mouth. They became with the sound of an F, that fricative sound, mouth. Truth became truth, and breath became breath. And I've heard relatives say, you know, I'm out of breath. And I still hear elements of that F. This is 150 years after slavery has ended. It still is a vestige of that period. And path becomes path. The R was very difficult. It was absolutely foreign to the language, to the languages that came over from Africa. They did not have the sense of the American R, just like so many don't. I think about how in Japanese, Japanese immigrants coming to America, how they have a difficulty sometimes with the letter R. So this R in spirituals, we see sometimes it is really neutralized. So instead of summer, it becomes summer. They try to stretch that sound, summer. Instead of torn, I tow it up, toe. Or instead of your, they said yo. Instead of your, or they say yo. And I don't mean like yo, Rocky in Philadelphia, yo, Adrian. It's yo. Oh, I don't know it's so hard to say it. But yo is an approximation of the R that's missing there. They stretch the vowel. For example, sometimes dialect like when Wade in the water, see that band all dressed in white? He's gonna trouble the water. Oh, the leader look just like the Israelite. So, oh, the leader look just like the Israelite. In saying this, you wanted to just kind of release it like, almost like American slang. Oh, the leader look just like the Israelite. He gonna trouble the water. And then it becomes a little less exaggerated in its sound. There's tone painting instances that we heard in some of the performances. Sometimes my students have a difficult time getting the right color or sound. And I suggest that they think in terms of a warmer or a darker sound, more ooh or oh into their tonal colors to round their lips and bring their lips forward. Sometimes my old teacher said, cover your teeth a little bit more because it was too bright sounding. And so those were ideas that I guess you can experiment to see if you can get the right color for many of those sorrow songs, I think, particularly. If you're singing unaccompanied. Here, in terms of tone painting and text painting or painting tones, that minor third that happens in this song, sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Maybe there would be a portamento on a minor third. maybe there would be a way to slide up to a note. A long ways from home. Maybe you would grab on certain syllables or grab on certain consonants to try to help bring the melody, to bring the message of the melody forward. Sometimes I feel like A Motherless Child is a wonderful one. This is the one by Burley that can really, you can really do some experimenting on bending notes and sliding notes and producing a rounder or a more warm sound. I guess if we're talking about improvisation, and this is where it gets a little, I guess, controversial, we have to consider the argument that Willis Patterson made when he talked about art songs and folk songs. Originally, these songs were group improvised song forms, and anyone could contribute to them. And a lot of people did in the making of these songs as they became forward in history. The controversy, I think, is when people want to take an art song arrangement and improvise too much on that. What I mean by too much is beyond interpolating a high note at the end or something like that. This is something that Hall Johnson used to allow people to do in his performances of his spirituals, and he was very picky. I think improvising too much in a modern style by adding lots of ornaments or melismas, that might actually be too much to improvise on top of someone else's folk arrangement. You might think about, if you really have a strong sense about that, that might be something that you could do more in an an unaccompanied spiritual. Beyond a note or two at critical points, like expressing, like, let's say, like Bach on the da capo, or Handel on the da capo. I think most composers kind of pull back from improvising too much in that setting. So beyond a few notes here and there, I think they want you to observe the form. I know if you speak to Eugene Simpson about that, who was active for decades here in NATS, he would tell you, no, Mr. Johnson wants you to sing exactly the notes he wrote there. If you want to do something else, do your own version of it, but not his. Okay. Oh, bless Dr. Simpson. Okay. Some other resources. Of course, we want to think about Willis Patterson. I think that's the screen I just went through. Okay, yeah, that's the one that we just went through. A lot of ideas come from the generations of composers as they've gone from the earlier, simpler settings of chordal settings to more complicated harmonic and rhythmic developments at the end of the first generation into the second generation, and now how it has really spread beyond that, and the spirituals being used expanded in the way the melody is treated, the way the harmony is treated, the way the way the text is treated, even. This is a condensation of the page in Randy Jones's The Spirituals Database, showing the development of the spiritual over these great composers and their arrangements. That's very useful. It also shows there's a collection of works by female composers, which of course we recommend. Oh, I gotta go faster. Okay, so we'll just have to trust me that Kathleen Battle sings beautifully at the end with James Levine. Yes, let's give her a little more than that. Yes, she sings that so beautifully, but she interpolates that note at the top. Okay, so Margaret Bonds, I'm sure, would allow that to happen. If you have a high D, then you're welcome to it. However, I guess that's where the controversy is in the art. Maybe not too much of that. Here is Florence Price, another female composer, sung by Leontine Price at the White House with David Garvey. Let me jump through here and see what she does. Note her speech, the pronunciation. Margaret Florence wrote that note at the end there for the soloist, but I like the individual quality that Leontine brings to tone. She sometimes gets into her chest voice in this kind of amazingly Laurel Mississippi way, and then she pops into her head voice in this kind of dramatic tone that she's able to produce. She's not everybody can perform it on Leontine's level, I must say, but I do enjoy the way she goes between those colors in her voice. She finds a great way to express these things. Here is a Betty Jackson King as a composer, and we have Louise Toppin singing, and she interpolates at the end of this as well. Here, let me see if I can give you just a little bit of this. How about a little more than that? How about this? Yes. Right. Dr. Toppin just adds her individual quality to the end of this piece. And sometimes people sing this work with a little bit of swing to the rhythm as well. So there is this energy of expressing and interpreting the rhythm to make it seem more fitting in that setting, I guess. Let me keep going. Here's Dr. Toppin also with this almost kind of jazzy quality in He'll Bring It to Pass, an arrangement by Joseph Joubert. Just a tiny bit of this as well. Okay, I'm gonna stop her there, although she's got a high E flat at the end of that waiting for you. So if you've got one, there you go. I would say definitely enjoy yourself. There are many new style arrangements of spirituals. Here is Damien Seed with Lawrence Brownlee singing Every Time I Feel the Spirit. I'm just gonna give you a fragment of this as well. Pardon me. Thank you. Right. You definitely get the sense that the harmony and the energy of the music is moving into a new idiom, the most modern style. Here's this is John Carter's arrangement. I'm sure all of you are aware of this one from the 60s. This is with Lawrence Brownlee as well. I'm going to jump too close to the end, not quite. Okay. Peter, go ring them bells, is the tune. So fantastic and so modern sounding from 50 years ago. Just terrific rhythm and energy and beauty, well expressed by Lawrence Brownlee. I need to go back one screen. This one is, there's a man going around taking names. This one is Jason Moran at the keyboard, who also composed it. You'll hear that modern quality. Let me see if I can give you just a fragment of this. Okay. I think I jumped a little too far for you. Maybe I can jump back just a tiny bit. Yes. Yes, there's a man going around taking names, and he uses the piano in almost a percussive kind of way, and Lawrence Brownlee's lyricism on top of that. It's quite a combination of idioms. I really do love it. I guess what I am now going to turn to in the last few minutes is that idea that we should probably get the second half of the story. Of course, spirituals are one half of the story, but the second half of American slavery is the idea of the African American narrative and how narratives actually, spirituals don't exist in a vacuum. Narratives actually tell more of the backstory. For example, here is a narrative about Ben Simpson, who in a very shocking way witnessed the death of his own mother as he and his sister and mother were coupled across the bottom of the country on their way from Georgia to Texas. And what he tells us in this tiny excerpt is a real insight into the idea of sometimes I feel like a motherless child. This idea of the sorrow that he expresses is so powerful. And so it gives you a real idea that this is more than a song, that this is history, and that the song, the history is necessary to understand or to get an understanding about the idea of the song. Sometimes, here's another. This one is Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen. And here we see Ida Hutchinson talking about the mournful spiritual Nobody Knows the Trouble I See as she witnesses 60 babies who drown, slave babies that drown in a trough during a rainstorm. And so that idea about the spiritual, nobody knows the trouble I see, and glory, hallelujah, I hope no one else does see that, comes so powerfully from her narrative. And we, even though she didn't create the song, Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen, that idea of the power comes through it. Maybe one is I'm on my way to Canaan land, and this one is Walter, who was a runaway slave And this is a real fragment, because his is pretty long, talking about running to freedom and living on the plantation and trying to find a way to find the North Star and running. And it starts to give us an idea about the text. I'm on my way to Canaan land, which was, of course, the code for to Canada, to freedom. Or Hannah Austin and Patsy Michener, when they talk about the abstraction and the ambiguity of being freed, we start to understand what "No More Auction Block for Me" really becomes. So those are wonderful ideas. So spirituals and narratives together actually tell us more about these things. They combine to, they light the way for us. They're witnesses to our American history. They teach us really more in more ways than a few, the unlimited possibility for human transformation. And they breach the void of distantly remoteness of American slavery, how far we are away from it. But reading these narratives, it really does bring us closer to the center of that experience and to the songs that remain from it. They speak their truth, I guess, through their narratives, and that is that's an important value to us. And now all we need is a way to kind of find these items together in order to make this critical path forward. I'm supposed to say thank you, and I'm supposed to give you a little bit of a show and tell. This is these are all in the notes. I think Eileen Gunter's book is really wonderful. It combines words and narratives and everything, just what you need. Howard Thurman really tells you about the quality and meaning of spirituals. That's also true in Vincent Harding's book. If you're going to only own one book about slave narratives, this is the one I love. It's Julius Lester's To Be a Slave. It's fantastic. It's also in the notes. And then the most powerful book that explains what the spirituals actually do, I have found to be Wade in the Water by Arthur C. Jones, who is not only a clinical psychologist, he is a music writer and an understanding of the spiritual. And if you need one history about slavery, The Great Stain, this is Witnessing American Slavery, a fantastic book by Noel Ray, just recently written last year. That's it.
Magnificently. Thank you, Dr. Plant.
I'm so sorry there was no time for questions, but if there were any, I guess I hope that you'll find me and I'll be glad to get back to you about that.
We'd love that. And, you know, we are hoping to move forward with these sessions again, this series, next year, and we'll find other opportunities. But this was so beautiful on so many levels, so informative and educational, and also just to listen to so many beautiful singers in that. I know they were snippets, but they were wonderful snippets, and they just make us all want to hear more of that, of course, and reminds us. So I have a quick question, but so
yes.
Okay for people who are not Black to sing with dialect? You think that's all right?
I think so. I think, of course, you have to kind of figure it out. And of course, there are many, many examples in modern culture to help you kind of understand where dialect is. And the idea is not to go to exaggeration, but to feel for it naturally within the confines of slang, I think. If you think of it like that, it may help you. When we write dialect, sometimes people get frozen into that, mm-hmm. and they feel like the exaggeration is what they're after, but not necessarily what you're after. You're after a sense of things, you're after a feeling for it. So we encourage everybody to think about it and to try their hand at dialect. And if they struggle with that, then there are thousands of other spirituals that are not in dialect that would be also very good to sing as well.
Excellent. Well, we thank you so much. And we thanks to all of you who attended today. We've been enriched by this hour and just can't thank you enough. So
you'll invite me back sometime. I'll try to finish that chapter about spirituals and narratives. I think probably that's the most important aspect, to get a sense of background about where the songs came from. And then all of a sudden you are open to them, understanding from your heart, and that's where the music comes from.
Clearly that is very, very powerful. And we're just very proud to have you as a member of New Jersey NATS, a long-term member. So have a wonderful afternoon, everyone, and thank you again.
Thanks so much. So long, everybody.
Bye. Thank you.